वेलकम टू वीलर्न। वीलर्न में आपका स्वागत है। वी आर डिस्कसिंग बैंकिंग ऑपरेशन सेशन 7 बैंक मैनेजमेंट। टॉपिक्स कवर्ड आर एनालिसिस ऑफ बैलेंस शीट, पर्पस एंड ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ बैलेंस शीट मैनेजमेंट, एसेट लायबिलिटी मैनेजमेंट प्रोसेस, लिक्विडिटी रिस्क मैनेजमेंट, करेंसी रिस्क मैनेजमेंट, इंटरेस्ट रेट रिस्क मैनेजमेंट, टायर 1 एंड टायर 2 कैपिटल, कॉम्पोनेंट ऑफ टायर 1 कैपिटल, टायर 2 सप्लीमेंट्री कैपिटल, टाइप्स ऑफ बोरोअर्स, टाइप्स ऑफ लेंडिंग्स एंड टाइप्स ऑफ चार्जेस। एनालिसिस ऑफ बैलेंस शीट। सो व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट बैलेंस शीट, फाइनेंशियल पोजिशन ऑफ अ कंसर्न, इट इज with all its strong and weak point is known with all the figures which are shown in the balance sheet. So the watching of these figure in an analytical manner is called the study of the balance sheet. And they have two aims. First is analyzing the past performance and to study the future projections in the light of what current figures show. When we talk about the purpose and objectives of balance sheet management, a very effective asset liability management technique, it basically aims to manage the volume, the mix and maturity, rate sensitivity as a whole to obtain the predetermined acceptable risk ratio. So it is basically aimed to stabilize short-term profits, long-term earnings and long-term substances of the banks. Now the parameters of stabilizing ALM system are net interest income, net interest margin and economic equity ratio. When we talk about asset liability management process, it takes into consideration the liquidity risk management, the management of market size, which includes the interest rate risk, funding and capital planning, profit planning and growth projection, trading risk management. So the main risks which are associated are as follows. The first is the liquidity risk management. So here managing and measuring is becoming a very vital activity for all the commercial banks. So by assuring that a bank's ability is able to meet its liability as and when they become due, liquidity management, it helps to reduce the probability of any adverse situation developing. So the importance of liquidity, it transcends individual institution. As a liquidity shortfall in one's institution, that can have repercussion on the entire system. So bank management, they should measure not only the liquidity positions of bank on an ongoing basis, but also examine how liquidity requirements they are likely to evolve under crisis situation. So there are other types of liquidity risk such as funding risk. So funding risk, they need to replace net outflows due to unanticipated withdrawals or non-renewals. Then comes time risk. Time risk, they need to compensate for non-receipt of expected inflows of funds. Then is call risk. It is crystallization of contingent liabilities. Another is a risk which is associated with currency risk management. The floating exchange rate arrangement has brought in its wake pronounced volatility, adding a new dimension to the risk profile of a bank's balance sheet. क्योंकि इंक्रीज्ड कैपिटल फ्लो है बिकॉज ऑफ फ्री इकोनॉमीज देर आर बिकॉज इट हैज हैपन बिकॉज ऑफ डी रेगुलेशन सो देर इज एन इंक्रीज इन द वॉल्यूम ऑफ ट्रांजेक्शन ऑल्सो देर आर लार्ज क्रॉस बॉर्डर फ्लोज टूगेदर with the volatility that has rendered the bank's balance sheets, which are vulnerable now to exchange rate movements. So dealing in different currencies, they bring opportunities as also the risk. So if the liability in one currency, it exceeds the level of assets in the same currency, then the currency mismatch can add value or erode value which is depending upon the currency movement. So the very simple way to avoid currency risk is to ensure that the mismatch, if at all it happens, is reduced to zero or near zero level. So bank, they undertake operations in foreign exchanges like accepting deposits or making loans and advances and quoting price for foreign exchange transactions. Then comes interest rate risk management, that is IRR. Now with the phased deregulation of interest rate and the operational flexibility which is given to the bank in pricing most of the assets and liabilities, they have exposed the banking system to interest rate risk. Interest rate risk is basically a risk where any change in the market interest rate, it adversely affects the bank's financial condition. Now, changes in IR, it might affect both the current earning and the net worth of the branch. The risk from earning perspective can also be measured as changes in the net interest income or net interest margin. There are certain components of Tier 1 capital. The more important it is, Tier 1 is basically more important among Tier 1 and Tier 2, and it basically consists of shareholders' equity. It is defined as the amount of paid up to the originally purchased the stock, that is shares of the bank, which are retained profits subtracting the accumulated losses and other qualifiable Tier 1 capital securities. So in a simple term, if the original stakeholder contributed $100 to buy their stake and the bank has made $10 in retained earning each year, since paid out no dividend, had no other forms of capital and made no losses, so after 10 years the bank's Tier 1 capital would be $200. So shareholder equity and retained earnings, they are now commonly referred to as core Tier 1 capital, whereas Tier 1 is the core Tier 1 together with other qualifying Tier 1 capital securities. Tier 2 or the supplementary capital, there are several classification of Tier 2 capitals, which is composed of supplementary capital. Now the categories are undisclosed reserves when we talk about. They are not so common, but they are accepted by some regulators where a bank has made a profit. Another is revaluation reserves. So a revaluation reserve is a kind of reserve which is created when a company, it has an asset revalued and an increase in value is brought to account. Then comes general provisions. So a general provision is created when a company is aware that a loss may have occurred but is not sure of the exact nature of the loss. Then comes subordinated term debt. Subordinated debt is classed as lower tier 2 debt, which is usually has a maturity of minimum of 10 years and ranks senior to tier 1 debt, but it subordinates to the senior debt also. When we discuss the type of borrower, the first is the Hindu undivided family, which is HUF. These are the people who have ancestral common ownership. They are covered Hindus, Sikhs and Jains who can form the HUF. Only the male members by birth of adoptions are co-parsoners. Senior most member is the Karta and it is not governed by the Partnership Act. Karta cannot revive a time-barred debt. Karta can compromise and refer to arbitration. He can give valid discharge to debt and make part payments. Borrowers can also include married women. Married women are basically a separate legal entity. So Section 14 of the Hindu Succession Act, it provides that property of a Hindu female is her absolute property. A married woman can also raise loan against her own property, solvency not related to the husband, and husbands are also liable for her debt. It has consented and stand surety. Then is called Pardarshinin lady. So Pardarshinin lady, wherein contract with her is not free from the defects. Presumptions of undue influence is there. Generally it is discouraged account in her name as her identity cannot be ascertained, and there is absolute care which is to be taken while dealing with her. Then comes blind person as a borrower. Here he gets an introduction and witness. Paragraphs need to be changed every 3 years and an identification mark is to be taken. Then comes illiterate persons. Illiterate persons, they get introduced and witnessed. The photographs need to be changed after 3 years. The identification marks need to be taken. The payment only in person through cashier only. Then comes insolvent person. So all the transactions made subsequent or during the last 6 months, they are invalid for insolvent person. They cannot obtain credit for more than rupees 50. Minors or lunatics, they cannot be declared insolvents. Then come insane person as borrowers. They are incapable of entering into contract. On notice of lunacy, operations need to be stopped and balanced, disposed of as per court's discretions and the directions. Then come intoxicated. The contracts which are made by a person in drunken state, they are void. So payment to an intoxicated person is to be made only after the two independent witnesses regarding the condition of the person is there. Then comes executor and administrator. The person who are named in the will of the deceased person is the executor, and the account can be opened on production of a probate. Person appointed by the court in an administrator, and must they produce a letter of intention. Then comes liquidator or receiver or assignee. Liquidator is basically assigned in case of a company in liquidation. The receiver or the assignee to manage the property of an insolvent person. The letter of probate or administration is to be taken. Then come trust as a borrower. When we talk about trust as a borrower, the trust deed is to be properly examined. Then insolvency of the trustee does not affect the trust property. The transfer of funds from trust account to personal account of the trustee, it needs to be investigated. So allow loans only if allowed in the trust deed and after taking personal guarantee of the trustee. There are societies and clubs also. They are by laws to be obtained and read very carefully. There is a registration certificate also. The resolution needs to be passed. Registration open and conduct of account. Then comes minor as a borrower. A contract with a minor is void ab initio. So a minor's account can be opened under the guardianship of the mother, father, or a legal guardian. There is no loan which is to be allowed even against the sufficient security to a minor. A minor can also be appointed as an agent, but it shall not be personally responsible to his principal, who shall be responsible for the acts of the minor agent. Another is agents or attorneys. So they are terminated upon the death or insolvency or insanity of the principal. When we talk about the types of lending, so there are usual types of facilities which are sanctioned by the banks to the borrowers, like project appraisals or post-sanction follow-ups. Now, bank lending can be categorized as fund-based and non-fund-based. When we talk about fund-based lending, so these are overdrafts. So overdrafts and all overdraft account are treated as current account only. So normally overdrafts are allowed against the bank's own deposits, government securities or approved share and or debentures of the company. Then comes demand loans. So a demand loan account is an advance for a fixed amount and no debit to the accounts are made subsequent to the initial advance except for interest. Then comes interest loan. Term loans. So term loans are sanctioned for acquisition of fixed assets like land, building, office equipments, for purchase of transport vehicles and other vehicles. Then comes cash credit advances. Cash credit account is a drawing account against credit granted by the bank and is operated in exactly the same way as the current account on which cash credits are allowed. Then comes bill financing. Advances against inland bills are sanctioned in the forms of limits for purchase of bills. Then comes packing credit. It is an extensive advance given to an exporter who holds a code number assigned to him by the Directorate General of Foreign Trade. Then comes non-fund based advances. Now, non-fund based of the examples are letter of credit. So it is issued by the bank at the request of the customer in favor of a third party, informing him that the bank undertakes to accept the bill. Another is guarantee. It is a contract to execute the promise. Then comes co-acceptance bills. Here the Reserve Bank has observed that some bank, they co-accept bills of their customers and they also discount bills co-accepted by other banks in a casual manner. Then comes types of charges. When we talk about types of charges, there are six types of charges. First is a pledge. Pledge is a bailment of goods by the debtor to the creditor with an intention to create a charge thereon as security for the debt. Then come hypothecation. When a pledge takes away control over the goods from the borrower, which may not be practical as the borrower would require certain goods under his control to continue its manufacturing and or trading activity. Then comes assignments. They refer to the transfer of rights or property or debt by one person to another. Then comes mortgage, is a mode of charge which is associated with immovable property. Then comes lien. A lien is the right of the creditor to retain the goods or security of the debtors which are in his possession until the debt due from the debtor is paid. Then comes lastly the set off, and it is the right of combining of accounts between a debtor and a creditor so as to arrive at a net balance payable to one or the other. To exercise, explain the asset liability management process and enumerate various types of borrowers and lendings. Thank you and have a nice day. Keep learning and be learning.